with you.
In God I trust, I will not be afraid.
When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you.
In God I trust, I will not be afraid.
When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned.
In God I trust, I will not be afraid.
I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Trust in me with all your heart.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave.
amazing it is for us to be able to sing those words. I am a child of God. We are children of the maker of the universe. You made each one of us. We are special creations of your hand. And you have made it possible for us to be your children. Your presence, Father, in your holy, perfect, righteous presence, in our sinfulness, we deserve nothing but to be destroyed. Yet because of Jesus, you have made it possible for us to not only be in your presence, but to call you Father. We've been told to call you Daddy by Jesus himself. We are so grateful for that. Thank you for the good news of the gospel, for the truth that Jesus paid the price for all our sins, made it possible for us to be forgiven, made it possible for us to be yours, to be your children, to belong to you, to worship you, to delight in you, to be in a relationship with you. Father, we are so grateful and we give you praise and glory today. We praise the name of Jesus. We lift him up as our great Savior, as our Redeemer, as the one made it possible for us to be your children. As the one who is the firstborn of the dead and has given us the promise and the hope of eternal life, as you raised him from the dead and he lives and reigns and is seated at your right hand, ruling over this entire universe. It's an amazing thing. Our minds can hardly even get around it. Father, we are grateful today that we can say that we don't need to be afraid. Because we belong to you, because we are your children. By faith in Jesus as our Savior, we have placed our lives in your hands, and you have promised to work all things for our ultimate good and to see us through and to carry us even through times of great difficulty. And even in the midst of facing death itself, we have hope. We have eternal hope because death does not have the victory. Death has been conquered. So grateful for that. Father, we're grateful for that as we think of Daryl and Gina Duncan and the loss of Daryl's brother-in-law, Gary Holder. Father, thank you for taking him to glory this week. Thank you for the hope of eternal life that was in his heart. We pray that that will speak comfort into the life of his widow and into the life of Daryl and Gina's family. Father, we pray for your grace to be poured out on them as they walk through this time of loss and grief. A special blessing on them on Tuesday as they lay Gary to rest and pray, Father, that the hope of eternal life and the truth of the gospel be proclaimed boldly because of Jesus, because of all that we have in him. Father, we thank you that we can be here together with your people, giving you praise and worship. We thank you for providing this place. We thank you for leading and guiding us as we are in this land. We ask, Father, that you will provide space for our offices that you need to guide the deacons with that. We pray that once again. Father, as the building team and the architects meet again tomorrow night, we pray for your hand to be on that time and on the process of envisioning what you have for us and discerning that. We pray for your leading and guiding, the Holy Spirit's presence in all of it. Father, we want to follow your will for us. And we know that you are leading. We pray that the Holy Spirit will guide and bless. Anticipate great and wonderful things from your hand, Father. You've done it in so many ways. We thank you again for the insurance settlement and the generous way that you've provided for us through that. Now we pray for your guidance as we move forward. Father, we pray for this week and the kickoff on Wednesday night. We pray that you that all will go well, that you bless us with good weather that night. We ask, Father, that it will be a great start to another great year of children's ministry and youth ministry. Our church. Thank you for the work that's been done on the youth house. Thank you for all those that worked so hard to make that happen. Thank you for the generosity of Bethel to make it possible. And Father, we anticipate just some wonderful things happening and lives being changed and impacted for Jesus in that space and through the children's ministries that will be going on this year, Sunday school as well. Thank you for the volunteers that have stepped forward to serve. We pray your blessing and your anointing and power of the Holy Spirit on them and on these programs. Father, we hold up before you this morning our brothers and sisters, all the people in Houston and in Florida. Father, power of your world, the incredible power and the helplessness of us as humans in the face of the power of your creation that is overwhelming. And we are reminded of that, and we are reminded of our need for you and how dependent we really are on you. Father, we ask that you will be with the people of Houston, that you will be with the people of Florida. We pray for your protection over them. We ask for you to direct and watch over people's lives during this scary time. We ask that you will use people to be a blessing, to be of help, help people to come together to alleviate the difficulty and the suffering that this has brought about. And Father, we thank you that there are so many opportunities in which people are stepping forward and helping and giving of themselves. Way that your love is being shown. We ask that even in the midst of this, that people will be reminded of your glory and reminded of your love that is being expressed in so many ways. So we hold that up before you, Father, and thank you that we are your children and we belong to you. We worship you, we glorify you today. We ask for your Holy Spirit to be part of all that we do. In Jesus' name. We're going to receive our morning tithes and offerings now and continue to give with a joyful heart, a heart of worship that praises our God as if we give from what he has given to us, and also a heart of worship as the praise team leads us in another beautiful song that lifts up the name of Jesus and reminds us how we depend on him.
Jesus, I
to say to us today. We ask that your Spirit will fill our time as we look at the story from your word that declares the great and awesome glory of God. Father, I ask that you will pour out your Spirit on me, on each one of us, that we will hear what we have to hear. Use me to say what needs to be said. May you be glorified in the name of Jesus. Pray in his name. So about 3 years ago, well, actually, exactly 3 years ago this month, Jody and I were doing something that we never expected to be doing. We were packing up our house in Chicago so that we could move to Sheldon, Iowa. Something we never expected to be doing. We had lived in Chicago for 25 years. Both of our boys had been born there. Ross was in the middle of high school and he was thriving. He was looking forward to all the opportunities of his junior and senior year at a great school. Jody and I both had jobs that we loved, working in a church full of people who had become very dear to us and were very good friends, such good friendships and relationships there. And we had every expectation that we would very likely spend the rest of our lives in Chicago. But things didn't go the way we expected. Changes had happened in the leadership of our church, and it became apparent that we might not fit with the new direction that our church was going, and the expectations that we had had for our lives and how they would play out suddenly looked very unlikely. Things that we thought would likely be the way that we would live out our lives, all of a sudden, it was all appeared that wasn't going to be. In fact, it became very apparent that God was closing the door on our life in Chicago and was pointing us back to Iowa after we had been gone for 30 years. And honestly, it was a difficult and uncertain time for Jody, for Ross, for Kent, for me. We were all living with this new reality that didn't go along at all with what we had expected and with how our lives would play out. What we all expected for our lives was not at all what was happening. Life is often that way, isn't it? It's often that way. This morning I want to look at one of the many stories in the Bible where the life of a person does not go at all the way they expected it to. It's found in the Old Testament book of Ruth. Ruth is a small book in the Old Testament. It's just before the book of Samuel, 1 Samuel. And it is written during the time of the judges. It goes Joshua, Judges, Ruth in your Old Testament Bible. And Ruth is this little book that's fit right in between Judges and 2 Samuel. It's just a short little book of 4 chapters. It's a beautiful story. It's actually a short story, beautifully written by an author who wanted to tell this amazing story. And the title of the book is simply Ruth. It has all the elements that we look for in a great story. If someone was to take this story to a literature classic, said, this is a great short story. It has all the elements in there. There's struggle, there's tension, there's tragedy, there's loss, there's love, there's loyalty, there's kindness, there's even romance. It has great characters that we all can understand and connect to emotionally. And it's obvious here from the name of this book, it's a story that's centered around a woman named Ruth. That's why it's called Ruth. It's one of 2 books in the Bible named after a woman, Ruth and Esther. And this morning, even though the book is called Ruth, and even though it's kind of centered around Ruth, we're not going to focus specifically on Ruth this morning. I want us to focus on Ruth's mother-in-law, a woman named Naomi. In many ways, this story is really her story, more so than it's Ruth's story. In fact, the book of Ruth begins with Naomi. It says in verse 1, in the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a man from Bethlehem in Judah, together with his wife and 2 sons, went to live for a while in the country of Moab. The man's name was Elimelech, his wife's name, Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem, Judah. That means the area around Bethlehem. It's called Ephrathah. So they were farmers out in that area. And they went to Moab and lived there. Now Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. After they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion also died, and Naomi was left without her two sons and her husband. And right there, just five short verses. This section in Hebrew is only 71 words. 71 words in Hebrew words in this section of Ruth. Right there in this short little section, the writer of this story tells how Naomi's life unfolded in a tragic way that she never, ever would have expected. Naomi actually means pleasant. That's the Hebrew meaning of the word, or in English, Naomi means pleasant. And you can just imagine Naomi as a young bride marrying Elimelech. You can imagine her anticipating their life together, anticipating a pleasant life, just like her name said it would be, a life that would be living out the meaning of her name. A home in the region around Bethlehem, living and farming on the land that was owned by Elimelech. They were blessed with two sons who would carry on their family name and bless her and Elimelech with grandchildren that would bring her joy in her old age. And like almost any other person in her position, Naomi expected her life with Elimelech to unfold in a happily ever after way. She had every reason to expect that. But then, the unexpected happens. There's a famine in the land. The farm's not producing. There's not enough food to eat. They can't make ends meet, and so they have to make the painful choice to leave their home and move to Moab. Far away from family and friends, here's a map that shows there's Bethlehem up there, and then they had to go all around the Dead Sea there. This is a journey of about 50 miles through some very mountainous kind of terrain, and they settled there in Moab. This was a long ways. It would take about 7 to 10 days to make this journey. They were far from home. It wasn't like just moving to Boynton and you could go back and forth like we could. This was going all the way to Sioux Falls and having to walk it. And so they were a long ways from family and friends, and they were living as foreigners among a people who were nothing like their own people, and who probably even had a historical dislike for Hebrew people. So there was sort of this hostility that could have been shown toward them as well. And not only that, they moved far away, living in this foreign land, then Elimelech dies. Her husband dies in this foreign land, leaving Naomi as a widow, and then her two boys die. Her two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, they die as well, leaving her with two Moabite daughters-in-law and no grandchildren. Naomi's life has become anything but pleasant. It has become nothing like what she expected it to be. Eventually, she hears that the famine in Bethlehem has ended, and she decides to return home. Now, most of us are familiar with the story of Naomi and her two daughters-in-law heading back to Bethlehem, heading back to the land of Judah. And there's this wonderful, beautiful, emotional story of Naomi telling Ruth and Orpah, don't stay with me. Go back. Find yourself some new husbands. I'm not going to be able to have any more sons. Even if I could, I won't wait around for them to grow up and marry them. You've got no point in sticking with me. Go back to your people. Go back and find husbands for yourselves. And there's this, they're crying and they're weeping as they think about this and talk about this. And finally, Orpah decides to follow Naomi's instructions, and she goes back, but Ruth says, no, don't tell me to leave you. Wherever you go, I will go. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. And there's this emotional story of Ruth showing her loyalty and love to Naomi, and finally Naomi relents. She realizes Ruth isn't going to be swayed to go back to Moab. She's going to stay with her, and they come back to Bethlehem. They return to their home. And there Naomi is reminded all over again, how the hopes and the dreams of how her life would unfold have been completely dashed. She's reminded again of how all that she expected her life to be was completely gone, totally unlike anything she had expected. And she's confronted with that as she comes back into Bethlehem, and she feels it so much so that she can't even bear to be called by her name anymore. It's like a slap in the face to be called pleasant when all this tragedy has happened to her, when her life has become so bitter. Here's what it says in the book, verse 19 of chapter 1. So the two women went on until they came to Bethlehem. When they arrived in Bethlehem, the whole town was stirred because of them. The women exclaimed, "Can this be Naomi?" "Don't call me Naomi," she told her. "Call me Mara, because the Almighty has made my life very bitter. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back empty." Mara means bitter. "Don't call me pleasant, call me bitter. That's what my life has become." You can just hear the incredible pain and disappointment in Naomi's voice. "I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back." Nothing has unfolded the way Naomi expected it to. She went away with a husband and two sons, and she comes back with neither. And for a woman of that time, having no husband or sons pretty much meant that you were destitute. There was no ability to claim or own property. Even the land that was legitimately owned by your husband, it could not be claimed by a widow. Someone in the family, a man, a male in her husband's family, had to be willing to take on the widow as his own wife and take on that property and carry on the man's family name. And Naomi could no longer have children, so she figured no man would have any reason to marry her. Why would they? She couldn't have children anymore. And she also must have assumed that no one would want to marry a foreigner like Ruth. Why would they take on a Moabite as a wife when they have plenty of Jewish girls, Hebrew girls, to choose from? And so what they seek to do, what they have to do, Ruth and Naomi have to fend for themselves. They're on their own. And that's what they try to do. They try to do that by having Ruth go out to the fields during the harvest to glean with the harvesters. They would put the grains, the barley harvest was in process then, and put the grain into sheaves, but the stalks of grain would fall down to the ground. They would gather them all up, and people like Ruth could come along behind the harvesters and pick those up and gather the scraps and get whatever they could. And so they send Ruth, or Naomi sends Ruth out to glean behind the harvesters, and the story unfolds, and it takes a wonderfully positive turn. Like you can hear the music change as the story unfolds with this beautiful, positive thing that happens. Ruth happens to glean in the field of a man named Boaz, who turns out to be a relative of Elimelech. And he's heard about Ruth, and he's heard how she has supported and cared for her mother-in-law, and he's impressed with the way she has been so loyal to Naomi. And he treats her kindly and generously. He tells his harvesters, "Need a little extra for her. Come and eat with us." Gives her roasted grain and lets her drink out of the water jars that his men have. He tells her, "Stay with my servant girls. Don't go to someone else and glean in his field. Stay with my harvesters." And he just treats her so kindly. And she comes back with all of this barley that she's threshed. And Naomi says, "What happened?" And she tells her the story. And Naomi realizes that Boaz is a relative. And she's thrilled to hear about the way that Boaz has treated Ruth. And she tells Ruth how to ask Boaz to be her kinsman redeemer. Kinsman redeemer is a family member who takes ownership of the relative's property. He marries his widow and produces heirs that carry on the dead relative's name
and the property ownership. It's not something that Boaz has to do. Boaz chooses to do, showing great character, showing great kindness to Ruth. He becomes the kinsman redeemer. He marries Ruth, and he buys Elimelech's land, and it's carried on through Mahlon's widow, Ruth, having children. It's actually not necessarily, it's the way the Hebrew law works is that this is part of Elimelech's descendants. Boaz doesn't have to do it, but he does it out of grace and kindness and love. And just as the story begins with 71 Hebrew words telling of the way that Naomi's life went in such a tragic direction, how it went from being full to empty, the book of Ruth ends with 71 Hebrew words telling how Naomi was blessed. Verse 13 of chapter 4. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. Then he went to her, and the Lord enabled her to conceive, and she gave birth to a son. The women said to Naomi, "Praise be to the Lord, who this day has not left you without a kinsman redeemer. May he become famous throughout Israel. He will renew your life and sustain you in your old age. For your daughter-in-law, who loves you, and who is better to you than seven sons, has given him birth." Then Naomi took the child, laid him in her lap, and carried him. The women living there said, "Naomi has a son." And they named him Obed. Isn't that a great ending? My friend Tom Smith says about this ending, "Can't you just see the author of this story writing down those last words?" And he puts down his pen, and he leans back in his chair, and he says, "Isn't God good? Isn't God good? Isn't it wonderful how he cared for Naomi? Isn't it beautiful the way that he worked all this out for her, for Ruth, and for Boaz?" But then he picks the pen up again, and he adds one more thing. Was the father of Jesse, the father of David. He puts down the pen again. He says, "Isn't God amazing? Isn't God amazing?" Here's the story of Naomi's life. From her perspective, none of it went in the pleasant way that she expected. And yet, in God's reality, it led to the birth of Israel's king. This David is King David, Israel's greatest king. And after all the painful and even tragic events of her life, God ultimately showed Naomi his love and his mercy, and he blessed her with a grandson. But he also used her difficult journey as part of his much greater plan for his people. Her great-great-grandson would be the great God is so amazing. He is so amazing. He is always at work. And the reality of what he is doing and what he is accomplishing is so much greater than our limited perspective. In the middle of things that we often walk through in life, we can only see just a little bit of what's going on. But God is so much greater. And not only is he at work in our individual lives, he is also at work on much greater things. Much greater things that accomplish his purposes. I can point to all kinds of things that God was doing and accomplishing when he told our family that it was time to move to Sheldon. He had our family going through unexpected changes. And from our perspective, it's like, this isn't the way it's supposed to be. But I can point to all kinds of things and ways that God has shown us, yes, this is the way it's supposed to be. This is exactly where I want you. And we've realized God's great love and mercy and grace to be here, to be in this community, to be with you, and to be walking through a time together that's so exciting, and seeing God do some amazing things. Many of you you've told me stories about your own life. And I've heard and I've read countless stories over the years about how God's greater purpose is being achieved often through difficult times, especially through unexpected times. And only God can do that. Only God can do, and He's doing it all the time. That is what makes it so amazing. He's doing it all the time. It's important for us to remember that. John Piper says, at any given moment, you may be aware of God doing three things at the most in your life, while at the same time as doing 10,000 things at any given moment. It's so important for us to remember that, especially when we are going through difficult things and unexpected things. When we see them happening, we go, this isn't the way it was supposed to be. And we need to remember who God is, what He's capable of, and how He often works. You know, we've been seeing a lot of stuff in the news this past week. This past week, I spent 2 days at a retreat in Sioux Falls, led by two people from Houston. Trisha Taylor and Jim Harrington were there. They live in Houston. They work with people in Houston. They are part of the church in Houston. And they described the incredible scope of the damage and the upheaval and the trauma in the wake of Hurricane Harvey. But then they also shared stories of what God is doing. Trisha talked about an elderly woman in her church. I think she's in her 90s. And she came to church on that Sunday morning, and this woman came to her and said, Trisha, I had to stay in the house of a stranger. A stranger took me in. I can't believe I was taken in by a stranger. A stranger took me in. And she's holding Trisha's hand and she's saying this over and over again. He's a stranger and he took me in. And Trisha said, he's not a stranger anymore. He brought them together. And the woman's eyes lit up. No, he's not a stranger anymore. He's someone I've come to love. I've experienced God's love through just one story. And Jim said, in all of this, the church in Houston is shining so brightly. Jim Harrington has been working for over 20 years to network the churches of Houston, to bring them together, doing all their own separate things, and start working together as the Church of Christ in Houston. 20 years they've been working with pastors and building this network. He says, you can't believe the way the church has come together and the way the church is shining so brightly in Houston right now. You don't hear that in the news. They're on the front lines and they see it every day. Churches working together, touching people's lives, making a difference, and declaring the love of God in Houston, showing His love. I just read an article this morning on Samaritan's Purse about this former atheist who is there in Houston showing the love of Christ and serving. Only God can do that. Over and over, people are coming together and they're doing exactly what God tells us that He wants us to do. What does God tell us over and over that He wants us to do? He wants us to love people and help those in need, no matter who they are. And that's what's happening there. It's going to happen in these coming days with Irma in Florida. Yes, it's awful. It's unexpected. It's the last thing we would want, but God can take that and use it to accomplish things that we can't even begin to imagine, to change lives in ways that we would never even have an opportunity to do other than in a situation like this. From our human, limited perspective, we think, how can this be anything but awful? And yet God, because He's so amazing, can do so many cool things through you. I read an article this past week by Randy Alcorn entitled, Trusting God When the Pain Seems Pointless. Trusting God When the Pain Seems Pointless. The article talks about how sometimes we walk through times of pain and we see any possible reason. It's pointless. Why am I going through this? I don't see any reason. And he talks about the stories of Joseph and of
Job and tell stories that he has heard about people. And sometimes we can't see it, we can't figure it out. But his reminder to us is that none of it is pointless. He says near the end of the article, faith is believing today what one day, in retrospect, we will see to have been true all along. What has been true all along? The truth is that God is in charge, and he loves me more than I can ever imagine, and that he is in control and working out his purpose, his reality, even when from my perspective, I can't see it. I can't figure it out. It's never that way for God. What has been true all along is that he is in control and he loves us. Our faith, the exercise of faith, is to believe that today. Because one day, looking back, in retrospect, we'll see that that was true all along. It's true right now. It's true for every one of us. It's true for us as Bethel Church. Praise be to God. Let's pray. Oh God, thank you that you are in control. Thank you that you can take unexpected things, things that seem like they are the worst things that can happen to us, and you can use them to accomplish your purpose, to achieve in our lives and in your world exactly what you want to happen. We ask that you give us faith to believe that. It's hard to believe that sometimes, Lord, because we don't see it. From our perspective, we can't. But you do. You can. And you can bring it all to achieve your ultimate purpose. And you are accomplishing so many things all at the same time. So help us to trust you. Help us to believe. Give us the faith that we need. And Father, today we do pray for your glory to be declared in Houston and in Florida and in Mexico. Father, may your glory be declared by your love being shown to people who need help. May we be part of that help. May your greatness, your presence be declared by your people, serving, loving, just as you tell us to. So, Father, for anyone here this morning who's walking through an unexpected time, I pray that you'll give them a sense of your presence with them, that you'll help them to believe, hang on, to understand that the pain is not pointless, that you will redeem it all because you have redeemed us in Jesus, and you are in the process of accomplishing your great plan and purpose for each one of our lives, for our church, for our world. So help us to continue to believe that. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand for sure.
Thank you for joining us in worship today. Have a great week and go in peace.